Well, it basically starts with the area management plan for the Roswell Field Office, which designated this as an area of critical environmental concern in 1997.
So in 2001, once Snowy River was found, the cave started expanding beyond its historic distance of about 6 or 7 miles to now over 44 and a half miles of passage.
Highlighting how important the area was, how significant it was both recreationally and scientifically. And so following on that in 2009, as part of the omnibus bill, this was designated a national conservation area, Fort Stanton Snowy River Cave National Conservation Area.
What sold it and what brought it about is the subterranean features in the cave. At that time, we knew of the Snowy River passages, but since the designation of the NCA has grown by leaps and bounds, we still have not found the end. What makes this area so unique and special is while we have a world-class resource underground, the above ground is equally as impressive with the pinyon juniper woodlands, grasslands we've got up to the Ponderosa Pine Zone. So it's really a treasured place, and we're fortunate to have it.
The cave is definitely a centerpiece and the reason for having it here, but there's so much more here. You have thousands of years of history. You have an incredible mix of wildlife. You have great opportunities for mountain biking, for hiking, for UTV recreation. This is a popular hunting place. So there's a lot for people to do here. We have 73 miles of trails and over 20 miles of road for people to drive on. This is literally an outdoor paradise for people who want to come experience their New Mexico and their public land.
My name is Debbie Beecher, and I'm a bat biologist. I live in Tucson, Arizona, and my colleagues and I have recently been specifically monitoring bats in different national parks and federal agencies for the presence of white nose syndrome.
So I've been a bat biologist for a long time. I did my master's on bats in Southern Nevada, and I've also worked in Arizona with bats. And so all the time I've been in New Mexico, bats have always been a part of my work. So white nose syndrome, when it first showed up, nobody really understood what was going on. They just started seeing these mass mortalities of hibernating bats.
There have been well over 6 million bats die from white nose syndrome as it marched west from that initial discovery in New York State.
We eventually understood that it was this novel fungus that was not known to be in the United States before, but additional research found that it was in Europe and also in Asia. The big difference was here in the United States, it was causing this major mortality of millions of bats, and it didn't do that in Europe and Asia.
And we were very concerned if it made its way here, we could see losses in the numbers similar to what the eastern portion of the United States had.
Knowing that we have a number of important bat roosts and hibernacula in the state that are managed by BLM, we became concerned and talked about how we should change our management, if we should change our management, and how that would be given the prospect of white nose coming to New Mexico.
It was obvious that we needed to do something to attempt to try and protect our bat species in our caves.
So the fungus tends to show up on the muzzles, on the ears, and on the portions of bats that don't have the fur. So that's the wings, often the tail membranes. T1, T1. So the biggest impact we see is on the wings.
The fungus is Pseudogymnoascus destructans. Once the fungus gets established on the bat and actually gets into the skin cells, it eats away at the walls of the cells and destroys the physiological functions. So the physiology collapses and the bat dies. It is now killing bats in Texas. And it's particularly killing the cave myotis. The cave myotis is found on BLM property in New Mexico.
So we're trying to figure out how to safeguard our bats while still allowing recreational caving to some degree.
We started holding a series of meetings, really outreach to the caving community and the science community. We were meeting quite a bit of resistance.
The bat biologists got together with the cave specialists and we all sat down and said, okay, let's work this out and figure out how we can best do this to where we can still allow science to happen in the cave. The extent of Fort Stanton and Snowy River is still an unknown. They're still finding new passages and things. So that's very exciting for the caving community. We didn't want to completely stop that. And yet we're so uncertain about how white nose is going to interact with the bats and whether we are going to see mass mortality in our western species.
The early days were very difficult because it was change. Change for the caving community, change for BLM. And there wasn't a lot of information out there to sort of base management decisions on, so we had to go with the best things that we knew. So this is a building we acquired to house our dedicated gear. We have things like helmets and coveralls for everybody. We can outfit about 25 or 30 people at a time. We have, like I said, helmets, boots, gloves, knee pads, arm pads, tons of packs. And then one of the other things that we figured out too is that a lot of cavers don't necessarily want to use gear that they don't know, right? It's safety is a very important thing and people feel comfortable with their things and especially in an environment where, you know, it's dangerous and there's risk involved. So we've also got bins over here on the far side where people can dedicate their own gear. They bring it here, they do the decon process on the gear, and then the gear stays here. And they just keep it here, it doesn't go anywhere, so now they can dedicate their own gear.
We're well aware that one of the primary vectors for spreading the disease is bat-to-bat transmission. Well, no matter what we do, we cannot control that, so it became evident the only control we did have was public access to the caves.
In 2014, BLM decided to restrict entries into Fort Stanton Cave because it's a hibernaculum. And those restricted entries are only going towards science and project type work, exploration, that sort of thing.
The recreational cave use, it just went away, it stopped. But we found a path forward and a mechanism internally to allow research and science to go forward. So those became our priority. Well, a lot of those trips take multiple people to pull together and actually perform the experiments and research that's going on in the cave. So we were able to, during that time, to utilize that caving community as well as our partnership, primarily with the Fort Stanton Cave Study Project. They got engaged and they were now part of the actual solution to keep, you know, these limited entries going.
One of the benefits of sort of limiting the recreational caving over the last 10 years is that we haven't had those, you know, just random impacts from very few users, but in a cave environment, you know, one person can wreak havoc in a very short time. So that's sort of a benefit. The cave has had a resting period without, you know, massive amounts of people going into it. We've also had time to be able to do some restoration work.
You know, we would engage anybody, everybody, have conversations, dialogue. We've had many universities, a very strong presence of the Fort Stanton Cave Study Project, which is a strong partner for us. And we kind of had to build a united front and common understanding, and it served us well.
I work in a microbiology lab with a geomicrobiologist who has been going into caves for a really long time. And she's been studying the external microbiota of bats to see how some may be more susceptible to the disease, whitening syndrome, which is emerging, and it's a pretty invasive and deadly disease and that we're really worried about in the Southwest.
We had heard that once P. destructans, Pseudogymnoascus destructans, got on a bat, it spread and changed the bat's microbiome.
And what she's also found, as other researchers have as well, is that there's certain bacteria, natural bacteria, that are on these bats that are resistant to the white nose fungus. And so a lot of researchers are looking at that, how those natural bacteria can be used to combat white nose. And I think that's probably where the answer to the white nose question will end up.
We're gonna go into the cave and we're gonna first look for the bats. They could be hidden in crevices, on the ceiling, on the walls. It just really just have to sort of keep an eye out, and it's really dark, so it can be hard to find them and spot them. They can kind of blend in.
We go in, everything we take in is sterile. We've deconned our equipment before we go in. We decon all the equipment we use on each bat. It gets fresh nitrile gloves for each bat.
And then we're gonna bag them, and I'm going to get all of my supplies ready. I'm gonna have a swab, I'm gonna have water, sterile DI water or ringers, and I'm gonna be dipping that into the ringers, and I'm gonna actually start swabbing the bat. We're gonna have a bat researcher, who's gonna be holding the bat the whole time and carefully ensuring that the bat doesn't get injured while I'm swabbing and that I don't get bit, that everybody is kept safe, and keeping the bat, you know, as calm as we possibly can during this time. And I'm gonna be swabbing the whole body, not the mouth or inside the nose or inside the ears, but it's gonna be the muzzle and the fur and the wings. So they're gonna spread the wings out. I'm gonna go back and forth to really try to capture everything I can possibly get from the bat onto the swab. So the goal is to get as much DNA on the swab as possible. And then later that swab is gonna be stored on dry ice and sequenced, and that's how we're going to study to see what's actually there and look at genes and microorganisms.
As a scientist, we always try to err on the side of caution, and we always like to put our species first, and so that's sometimes the push against management sometimes, is because of course we are a multiple use agency, and so there's other things to consider.
With our partners, with our local staff here, and we're able to successfully make informed decisions based on that science, that we had reasonable assurance that we were gonna not alter and jeopardize our bat colonies.
Working with bats, I didn't realize how much I loved doing that, you know, until I really started to. So it's kind of fun. When you start getting deeper into science, you really start kind of seeing those things that spark that interest. And I didn't expect that. There's so many fields, it's such a broad thing, and there's just so much you can apply to it. So I really feel like I had a deeper appreciation for the species and for this host after I started working with them. And I was surprised by that. I was surprised by how amazing and cool they are. And when I start looking at the data on, you know, a computer, you can sort of start visualizing how cool that stuff is too, and then you can really apply it to so many things. So that's what I'm really, really excited for, and I was surprised by it.
You know, I think one of the best parts of this is how the science community and the caving community and management have all learned to work together fairly well. When we first started asking for BLM to limit access or even restrict access to some of these caves, we got a lot of opposition, primarily from the caving community, because, you know, things had been wide open to them before and they'd been doing some great projects and supporting other kinds of science. And so all of a sudden we show up saying, we don't know what's going to happen, we don't know when white nose will get here, we don't know how it will impact our bats, but we want you guys to basically change the way you're doing things and start doing decontamination and being very careful and being less disturbing to the bats. And they've always been very conscious of the bats and appreciative of the bats anyway, but we did want things to change. And so it took several years to kind of have everything, the push and shove back and forth, and basically to come to an agreement of how we were going to go forward.
So the Roswell Field Office has been a leader in decontamination of cave gear and developing processes for using science-based methodologies that have been developed by Fish and Wildlife and other organizations to be able to prevent the spread of white nose syndrome. So what we've done is we've switched to completely dedicated gear at Fort Stanton Cave, and that gear never leaves here and it doesn't go anywhere. So these decontamination processes, otherwise known as decon in the cave world, involve basically sterilizing cave gear. If you go caving, you're recontaminating it and then sterilizing it again.
And so I think we've reached the point now where it's much more comfortable. And of course, after seeing millions of bats die from white nose in the East, you know, it's been kind of a wake-up call to all of us. Even though we haven't seen that mass mortality in the West yet, we anticipate that it will probably be no different here. And so, you know, people are much better educated about the impacts now.
It's really cool to see a lot of passionate people come together. You know, I love working in caves. It's an amazing place. It's really, really fun. It's really kind of like a wondrous, mysterious space, and it's nice to see scientists come together and collaborate, and we're all interested in the same thing, so we're all kind of gearing up and fighting to get in here and really, really like answer these questions. So that's been wonderful. It's been a really good experience. I'm super happy to meet other people and to collaborate like that.
I think we've done very good working together to try to, you know, come up with our best solutions for getting where we want to go.
Trust your staff and build them up and watch them grow. And because by no means am I an expert at any of this. I'm simply the manager that gets to sign the documents some days, but you know, you've got to empower and encourage your employees and staff and just watch them go. It's been a lot of fun. We've got great resources up here, but we've got folks that love their work and it shows.